Hello, and welcome to Allegheny County Library's Let's Get Lit. Well, this is where we talk about exciting titles so you, our patrons, can know what to read next. We will be talking about hot new titles to the library and also still burning titles, which may be older but are ones we have loved. Let's Get Lit is available in video format on the ACLS YouTube as well as in podcast format on Apple, Google, and Spotify, so you can subscribe for updates when we release new episodes. Let's Get Lit will be bi-monthly, and we would love your feedback as we do this. Contact information will be in the description as well as at the end of the episode. Any titles mentioned will have links to our catalog in the description as well. Now, let's get lit.
I'm Allie.
I'm Shane.
I'm Liz.
I'm Laura.
March Movie Madness, Part 2.
What movie completely deviates from the book and is better for it?
I don't know if it completely deviates, but I love The Wizard of Oz. They did this screenplay originally, like they had her shoes silver and like the different things like that, like in the book. And then they came along. I forget who did it. It was like, I want to say Mervyn LeRoy, but I don't know if that's correct. But I think he came in and made changes to the script and made them ruby slippers and like changed a lot of things and like gave us the classic that there was today. And I had watched the movie from like the time I was a small kid. And then when I was like 10 or 11, I read the first one, and I was like, this is horrible. Like, I don't know what is happening here. It offended me. Like, I think it was the first thing I ever read where I was like, wait a second, there's changes here? Like, so I did not like it at all.
Did you watch Return to Oz?
Yes, I didn't like anyone. Did you like Return to Oz?
Yes, I love that movie.
Of course you did.
It's scary as hell.
It's scary how bad it was.
Silence of the Lambs.
Super popular.
It won all the awards.
Yeah.
I think that the way it's shot is better for the story because, you know, I don't know if you remember, but the camera's like right on your face. So when Hannibal Lecter's talking to Clarice, he's staring directly at the camera and staring directly at you. So that's like an empathetic style that I think that the story in the book just does not have. The book has a lot of like misogynistic stuff in it,
oh, yeah.
Like, where like it's very explicit in how like things that men say to her and words they use, and it's pretty rough. But I think that it gets across better in the movie where she's shot with, framed with men the entire time. Like there's this famous shot.
I never thought of that, but you're right.
She goes into the elevator and like she's just looking around and like, there's men all around her, and like the way that they look at her. And
yeah,
I think
right.
I think it better explains where she's coming from and what a Hannibal Lecter sees in her, and how he's trying to unlock her mind.
So he can manipulate her.
Well, I think honestly, he has an admiration for her at the end. I don't think it's.
I think he was bored, and she was interested.
No, I think that they have a true thing that. They had like the scene in the movie where they have the quid pro quo back and forth where they're exchanging details.
They never
themselves filmed
face like beside each other either because
right.
one of them was always behind glass,
right.
which was interesting to have that much chemistry with another character that you're something's always between you in.
Yeah, it's really great casting too. You know, Anthony Hopkins was not the first choice for it, supposed to be Sean Connery.
Oh. Well, that would have brought a different spin.
Gene Hackman bought the rights to the book first, and then he wanted to do it, and they felt...
Did he want to be Hannibal?
He wanted to be Hannibal Lecter.
Oh, that's a whole nother
and directed it, yeah.
Thing. Mine would be Nerve, which is kind of surprising that it was adapted anyway, because it's kind of not a super well-known YA book. And the movie basically just took the premise that you could be a watcher or a player within kind of a secret game that is happening, and that was the only thing they took from it, and then they just reconstructed the whole storyline to something else because the book was so nonsensical and just over the top and just was weird and wild and so unbelievable, and then they made it just enjoyable. I mean, it's still not like the most realistic thing of all time. Good time. It's exciting. The characters are much more relatable. It's like one of my all-time favorite movies, too.
Nerve?
Yep.
Dude, the hits just keep on coming.
Emma Roberts, Dave Franco,
oh, yes.
Machine Gun Kelly.
Can I see? Who is Dave Franco? Can I please see this? You would know him.
From Neighbors.
Oh, okay.
He's been in a lot of stuff.
Well, Allie, I mean, don't take it personally. Allie's yelling at me right now. I'm sorry. I have no idea what you're talking about.
Oh. Okay, that's a really good...
Does anyone else know what she's talking about?
I
I remember that.
I mean, it was marketed to more of a teen. Well, I just like it because it's exciting. I like the idea of like the watcher, the player, and there's these dares that they have to compete in. But if they don't do the dare, they lose like everything, and their like identity is given out to some not so great people. And
I don't have an answer to that.
You have got 22 pages.
But not to that. Right here it says, I don't have an answer.
But what's on that?
Let me share for that one. I don't have an answer.
What is on that? There's so many notes.
Well, I'm going to throw some things in if I can eventually.
James Wells' Frankenstein from 1931. It's completely different than the Mary Shelley book. Mm. It takes the basic premise.
You're nodding your head like you know. Have
I
you
don't
seen
know.
This?
Enough that I know. Oh, okay. Carry on.
James Wells, Frankenstein, 1931. But it's based on a book called Frankenstein by Mary Shelley. Takes the premise of, but then does a gothic horror movie. I would say pioneers the gothic horror. They had to invent, you know, makeup techniques, shoot the way they wanted to on the sets, which still look fantastic in the year of our Lord, 2021.
That's a very formal way of it.
Well, I have a great reverence for this movie.
Wow, I can tell. You're like serious, super serious, and you're using like old King James English titles right now. What's happening?
The movie also introduces one of my favorite tropes in fiction, which is the lovable monster. The monster as the victim. Frankenstein's monster is definitely one of the best examples of that.
Yeah.
But then the takeaway from that is Frankenstein's monster has been turn in the same bucket as Dracula, which is, you know,
Herman Munster.
Yeah. It's a really, really tender and sweet performance by Boris Karloff as Frankenstein's monster, who has to put up with a lot of garbage from the people who bring him back to life.
Yes.
He didn't ask for that.
No, he didn't.
And he doesn't have his own hands or his other limbs, appendages, and he just has to make his way through the world. And then they burn him to death.
I'm trying not to laugh, but the way you said, okay, it's not funny to burn a monster to death, but I wasn't expecting the eloquence of your description. I'm sorry. I'm trying not to laugh.
Check it out. If you want to see a more true to the original story, the fiction of Frankenstein's monster, watch season one of Penny Dreadful, which I think is a great adaptation of that story.
Coraline.
Oh,
you are right. Go for it. Coraline, the book. It's not a good time. It's not a good time. It's very boring.
Oh, it's bad.
Coraline has absolutely no personality.
None.
I don't know how kids read it and enjoy it.
It's bad.
There's nothing to it. It's not scary. Whereas the movie adaptation is, the first time I watched it, I was an adult when I watched it, and I was scared watching it.
Well, the
it's, other mother is so creepy, and it just takes.
When she does her nails.
Yes, the atmosphere of it is so much better than
the father at the piano.
Than the book. Yeah, the book just, it's kind of like, here's the framework for it, and then
I think that takes the cake.
The movie gives it so much personality.
It made me think of when we were in third grade, and we had to read James and the Giant Peach, and then the movie, because the movie was coming out, it was around third grade, and we went to see the movie, and it was terrifying. Everything looks otherworldly, and I think that's more or less what Coraline does really well, too.
Yeah.
But Coraline's story is better suited to that. James and the Giant Peach is trying to be like a heartwarming tale.
Yeah, like a really, for him, for Roald Dahl, like, yeah, that's heartwarming for him. Yeah.
Movies or series you might not realize were adapted.
Liz, do you have any answers?
Undoing.
I don't know that one.
It was just on with Nicole Kidman and Hugh Grant.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't know it was a book.
Oh, I have not heard of it.
You might not realize it, but Die Hard is based on a book.
Really?
Hang in there. It's based on a book by Roderick Thorpe called Nothing Lasts Forever. So it's the second book in the series about an ex-detective named Joe Leland.
Uh-huh.
The first book is called The Detective. It was made into a 1968 movie starring Frank Sinatra. So when the time came to adapt the second book, Nothing Lasts Forever, it was written into Frank Sinatra's contract that he had to be consulted to see if he wanted the role of that
How
eventually became
that
John McClane.
connection or power.
In 1970? Frank Sinatra had that much because
I guess. Well, yeah.
But he did have some
kind of his hair.
So yeah, the Die Hard could have starred Frank Sinatra. He would have been 70 years old when he played the part. Unfortunately, that didn't happen. And yeah. Apparently, the first movie, The Detective's really good. I've never seen it, but check it out. We want to move on to favorite movies based on books. Or our top 10.
Or just favorite movies.
Or we could do favorite movies that you wish was a book.
And television shows that are the best of all time, like The Sopranos.
The Godfather. In the same vein.
That's better than the book, for sure.
Yeah, and so third one, I tried to struggle through that one, and I just couldn't. But they revamped it.
Yeah.
But I have not seen it. Have you?
Yes.
I have not.
Is it much better?
No.
Okay. Well,
just don't
I don't mean
watch
to say anything
it.
About
don't
Sophia Coppola.
Oh gosh.
But her acting was
oh,
not
bad.
Good, and that's what totally turned me off.
So do you know who was supposed to play that part?
Somebody better than her.
That would have been anybody.
Winona Ryder was supposed to be.
Oh, that would have been phenomenal.
And then she made Dracula with Francis Coppola after that as a makeup gift. She gave that to him.
She did a good job in that. Hey, you know what movie? I didn't read the book, Chocolat.
Oh, with Johnny Depp?
Oh, first of all, I almost didn't realize that was him. And my girlfriend and I were like, who? He is so hot. And then I realized who he was. I was like, no, he made that movie.
Yeah.
He really did.
The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo, the U.S. version. I really wish they would have continued on. I haven't actually read the books, though.
Oh.
So.
I have. I read the first three, the ones that he actually wrote. I haven't
yes,
read any
yeah.
that he didn't write. And
but I've heard such good things about them that I can... You know,
the first one, you gotta hang in there with it. I'd say the first half, and then it takes off and it's phenomenal because I was just like, dear God, what? But everybody said, stay with it. And so I did. But yeah, I read that all three that he wrote in there. I really liked it.
The movie left such an impression on me.
I've never seen the movie.
Oh, it's
oh,
fantastic.
Man.
I'll have to.
I would say the only misstep is Daniel Craig.
And I think he was the hangout.
So Daniel Craig, in The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo, he was already Bond at that point.
Mm-hmm.
And so he was getting a lot more opportunities. I think he might be slightly miscast as Blomkvist, is that his name?
I think so, sure. Yes. I haven't read them.
Because he's more of a journalist in the books, you know. He's more
yes.
of a
oh, yeah, yeah.
not a action.
No, he's not an action in the books.
And Rooney Mara has
yes,
Elizabeth Salinger's really, I think she's better than Noomi Rapace in the Swedish version. I wish they would continue that. David Fincher said he wants to do it.
Knives Out's one of the best movies I've seen in years, and The Sweater.
Yeah, I like The Sweater, I don't like him.
Christopher Plummer, you will be missed.
That's really sad.
Knives Out's a great movie. It feels like it should be from a book.
It feels like it should be from an Agatha Christie book.
I'm going to talk TV series. The Last Kingdom is probably my favorite currently. Which is based on a book, but I've heard not so fantastic things about book series, so.
Is that the one that you and Brian were watching and you're like...
Yeah, Uhtred, Son of Uhtred!
That's like, oh yeah.
I love me some Uhtred!
I know you do! I know you do.
For fans of Vikings, and I don't think it would be really comparable to Game of Thrones.
I mean, yes,
it's
a
missing
it's
kind
a good
of like
starting
that.
Point.
Yeah.
I'll say one of my favorite movies based on books, and I've actually read the book and love it. It's Charles Portis's True Grit. True Grit is...
It's good.
I'm talking about the Coen Brothers one.
I like the Coen Brothers one better.
It's very faithful
Tarzan.
To the book, and it keeps all the dialogue and characterization.
And
you know,
Matt Damon and... It's fantastic.
Absolutely. It adds some Coen-esque weirdness, and it has a beautiful sense of adventure and sentimentality that the book doesn't really have. But I would say that the 69 version you should skip because it ruins the Rooster Cogburn character.
It does not.
And leans too much into the John Wayne persona. That's the truth.
But you can't have a John Wayne movie without a John Wayne persona.
He doesn't fit the role. I wanted to talk about two things related to the book Watchmen. The series just came out recently on HBO by Damon Lindelof, who did The Leftovers, which is another adaptation of a really good book that he made better. But the movie was done a long time ago by Zack Snyder, and it was a huge, huge misfire. Because I think, and this is a problem with the adaptations, he's tried to recreate frame by frame the comic book panels of the graphic novel. Apart from that, there's, I don't know if you've read Watchmen, but there's every significant scene has a more or less a soundtrack on it. Like it, all the lyrics have direct references to the action in the story. But when Zack Snyder translated it to the screen, he put those tracks on top of the scenes, and it's just so on the nose and awkward that it ruins the action that's playing out. The Damon Lindelof HBO series called Watchmen takes the spirit of the comic and like takes it to another level that matches the same. It's trying to reckon with similar themes. Point in the world, racism is the chief topic of the series and how that affects policing and communities that have been overtaken by white supremacy. It also has superheroes in it. So, yeah, I would say that's how you do a good adaptation. What other movies did you
see? The Royal Tenenbaums, if you haven't seen it, see it. Anything by Quentin Tarantino. It really start with Once Upon a Time in Hollywood and Inglourious Basterds. They're the best. And Reservoir Dogs. They're not for the faint of heart. Get familiar. Also, if you like Westerns, The Unforgiven with Clint Eastwood and The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. Watch The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly first, and then watch Unforgiven.
Okay, we're talking about upcoming ones. The Woman in the Window is supposed to come out this year. It was supposed to come out, I think, last year. And they keep pushing it, yeah. And, you know, for fans of Girl on a Train and Gone Girl.
Yes.
And the book was really good.
It was.
And then, I already mentioned it, but Shadow and Bone, Netflix is adapting.
Oh, that's right.
And that's based on Lee Marvin's fantasy Grisha world. I have high expectations.
We shall see, won't
we? We will.
Netflix usually does a good job.
I think that they do.
They do.
Surprisingly, I really like the To All the Boys I Loved Before series. I think that those did a really great job at capturing the atmosphere of those books.
Their remake of Rebecca was pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Did you not like it?
No, I like the original Hitchcock.
Well, Hitchcock. I mean, it's hard to beat. But it wasn't bad. I didn't hate it.
I like the atmosphere.
Everything about the original was better. Jim Fontaine, the whole nine.
Yeah.
It's hard. Laurence Olivier. It's hard to beat.
Tales of Peter Rabbit.
I'm wait, what?
Tales of Peter Rabbit.
Oh, I didn't hear what you said.
Adults and Kids Are Gone. The Nightingale, which I already mentioned. Bear Town by Frederick Backman. It's a series. The Last Letter from Your Lover. That's by JoJo Moyes.
Oh, Racy. Okay.
I would have for these episodes.
Thank you for joining us for Let's Get Lit. Don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss out on future episodes. If you have any questions, suggestions, or want recommendations, please contact us either in the comments section, by giving us a call, or by emailing us at letsgetlit@alleghenycountylibrary.info.